A groundwater shortage might be the last thing you'd expect to face on the shores of Lake Michigan, but that's just what people who live and farm in one lakeshore county are dealing with. Partner station WGVU in Grand Rapids, Michigan brings us the story.
You look at where we are situated, Ottawa County, of 30 plus miles of shoreline next to Lake Michigan. Water is ubiquitous here. We have a water problem. We thought it was isolated till we started to get the results back from the study.
Ottawa County is located in West Michigan. More than 290,000 residents live here, and they're wrestling with an expanding groundwater shortage. It was first revealed here at Highland Trails.
The subdivision is the epicenter of the issue in central Ottawa County that triggered the need for us to better understand what's happening underneath our feet with groundwater.
When was that? When did that happen?
It was in 2008 when we were notified of residents in this location at the subdivision who were running out of water. They woke up in the morning, turned on their faucets, and had no water coming out of the pipes.
Paul Sachs is Ottawa County's Planning and Performance Improvement Director. He explains the groundwater wells had run dry. Allendale Township took emergency measures connecting Highland Trails to municipal lines drawn from Lake Michigan. It triggered a study conducted by Michigan State University and Michigan Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering exploring the county's geology and its two primary aquifers, the shallow and sandy glacial drift aquifer and the deeper marshall bedrock aquifer. In this animation, the shift toward dark blue shows the decline in static water levels over the past 50 years.
Look closely at the central parts of Ottawa County. These areas exhibit the most significant declines.
Nearly 11,000 residential, industrial, and agricultural wells are depleting the aquifers.
They were drilled into the Marshall Formation, and the Marshall Formation then was depleted because of all the people drawing from it. So if we have 40 houses doing 20 gallons a minute, what do we have? 40 times 20, we have 800 gallons a minute that is being drawn. That's a lot of water in an area that has only a couple acres.
That's 24/7, year-round, compared with periodic farm irrigation spread over large swaths of land 3 months out of the year. John Yelich is the director of the Michigan Geological Survey at Western Michigan University.
The geology here is very complex because it doesn't have an area where you can recharge rainwater coming in and recharging the aquifers. It's very limited, and that's what restricts how much water we really have, whereas there are other parts of the state where we have enough rainfall, it recharges the aquifer and people are satisfied.
But in parts of Ottawa County, the aquifer can't refill fast enough to meet the demand. There are too many areas of clay preventing snowmelt and rain from soaking back in. The scientific findings were presented to Allendale Township at the epicenter of the challenges.
And at the very end of that presentation, I asked the commission, do you have any questions? And there was silence in the room. There were jaws that were dropped.
What was the big finding that caused that reaction?
Our water levels are declining. They've declined 40 feet over the last 50 years, and it's not replenishing. Allendale Township is the fastest growing township in Ottawa County. It's also one of the fastest growing communities in the entire state of Michigan. When you are growing as a community, and the economic development and vibrancy is dependent on that growth, and you find out that there's a water issue, that's going to make you stop and think, what are we going to do moving forward?
Allendale Township now requires every new development connect to municipal water, and nearby in Olive Township, it's declared a moratorium on new housing developments using well water. The farming community is also under the gun. Ottawa County is a state leader in agriculture production. And back in 2008, not far from Highland Trails, farmer Merle Langland had no shortage of well water for irrigating, but he was noticing his crops wilting and turning yellow.
We had underneath the pivot, the soybeans looked the worst. And it should have been the opposite. Where we irrigated, it should have been the best. So we got investigating, and yeah, there was chloride in the water.
We're a unique area. It's called the Michigan Basin. And it's essentially a bowl that essentially was seawater since 600 million years ago. And it all forms salty formations, and they all have salt water in them.
As groundwater levels dropped, irrigation wells were drilled deeper, drawing briny water, damaging crops. The study revealed some of the more densely populated areas are experiencing a double whammy: declining groundwater levels and elevated groundwater salinity. So, how to address the issue? There are municipal water lines pumping water from Lake Michigan, but with limited capacity.
And there's two, there's Grand Rapids and there's Wyoming, and then Holland also has a small pipeline that's coming in from the lake. But remember, the water needs to be appropriated from the compact. And that, of course, includes Canada plus all the Great Lakes states. So in order to draw water out of it, you have to get approval from all of those, and then there's a cost. The cost estimate is over $100 million to put another pipeline in.
What would the sources be to pay for that?
I wouldn't even venture a guess. I can't.
And it's not just Ottawa County dealing with the problem. Armed with study results, Yelich and Sachs are on a mission to reshape water use habits before it's too late. With the help of community and business leaders, they're formulating a groundwater mitigation plan. It begins with an education campaign followed by initiating change.
Water conservation, landscaping, and irrigation, how we handle those things traditionally with green grass and abundant irrigation, those practices need to change.
Christina Kisner and her family moved to Highland Trails nearly 6 years ago.
I think there's probably some things that the residents could do in terms of coming together and brainstorming and thinking about ways that we can help contribute to helping the problem.
What we're looking at is that we have landscape that's not really taking advantage of the fact that we have a low water supply here. And we should be doing something to put zeroscape, put things in that use less water.
What is zeroscape?
Zeroscape means substituting some of these grasses for rocks and other things that do not require any kind of water.
Traditional development patterns can't continue. To have high density residential developments with small lots in areas that don't have municipal water but are dependent on groundwater shouldn't occur. We're also looking at overlay zones for land pattern development. There are areas of the county where there is recharge to that deep formation. We need to know where those areas are, and we need to protect those areas for recharge. We just can't develop our land blindly, knowing that there is a water resource concern.
And the county is partnering with farmers too.
We're working with the Drain Commission here in the county as an example of how we can pump the water out of the ditches, put it into ponds so that it can be effectively used for agriculture in local areas, but also how it can be put onto the fields as well.
A number of years ago, we dug this pond, and this catches all that water. The irrigator back there in the distance, that's what we use to apply it to the field in the summertime when we need it.
How much water is here?
Boy, I don't know. I'm guessing this is a good 10 million gallon.
It's not for drinking, but it does the trick. A similar tactic can be applied in urban settings.
Gray water is, say, the water from your dishwasher, your shower, your sink, your washing machine. You have a chance to route that water and reuse it. I understand, you know, we talk zeroscaping and native landscaping. People have this desire for green, lush lawns and landscapes. Why use fresh drinking water for that?
If things don't change, what's the outcome?
We could have places that are not going to have groundwater for drinking water supplies. That's bad.
People won't be able to sell their homes.
That's the worst thing. You find out that you don't have it, they may have gotten a loan on it, but the value of the house has just gone down. That's right.
So it's going to take really a punch in the gut for people to get this.
And what we hope is that we don't have to do that. We're providing enough information and enough background after this 6-7 year study that has been done. And the things that we're showing right now is that if we conserve and we do it, we can survive and everybody can be happy.
For more on these stories and the Great Lakes in general, visit greatlakesnow.org. When you get there, you can follow us on social media or subscribe to our newsletter to get updates about our work. See you out on the lakes.